Thank you, Markus, for this introduction. I have decided not to use presentations, not to follow the PowerPoint line, because I want to make it informal. Don't hesitate to stop me or interrupt me with questions if you wish. And if we would have here a serious discussion of technology transfer from basic research to industry, we should devote not about an hour, but days and weeks. There's so much to discuss. So I will simply choose a few items, some of them of personal nature, personal not related directly to me, but things I've experienced and I've seen from a short distance, and a few topics which I feel should interest a relatively new institution like IST Austria. I'm already saying relatively new because it's already about 10 years old, but 10 years in the life of a science institute is a very short time. It's, I guess, still a baby, or maybe beginning to move from a baby to a little child. And so it will be a rather random selection of subjects, but I will try to put some order into it. I'd like to start by saying something that you all know. And that is that we live today in the world in what you might call the age of knowledge. For the first time really in history, in human history, knowledge has become the leading economic commodity. Knowledge in general, scientific and technological knowledge in particular. Not only scientific and technological. There are many other aspects of knowledge which I will not get into today, which are as important, which are as valuable, but science and technology knowledge are the leading commodity. You can look at a few statistics. Singapore has about 5 million people. Pakistan has about 170 million people. Both of them have no natural resources, no oil, no minerals, no significant resources. The gross domestic product, the GDP of Singapore, absolutely is larger than that of Pakistan. 5 million Singaporeans are producing more than 170 million Pakistanis. And that is only because of knowledge. Singapore is a fantastic example to choose because it started from a group of fairly uneducated Chinese peasants who were turned into a nation which is one of the most educated and best educated nations in the world. Another example may be Germany and Iran, two nations with approximately 75 million, between 70 and 80 million people each. There is a ratio of like between 1 month and 1 year between the GDP of the two countries. What Germany produces in a month, Iran produces in a year, including all the oil. And there you see for the first time a comparison of a country with natural resources with a country which now has much less natural resources. There are many other examples. I'll mention only one more. Apple, the Apple company, sales in 1 year are larger than the oil sales of Venezuela and Iran combined. And that is really mind-boggling because that gives you the relative importance to the world economy now of technology and knowledge versus natural resources. There are several problems with the economic value of knowledge. One is time delay. There are no quickies. There is nothing which converts knowledge to economic value very quickly. There's simply no such thing. And that already puts it outside of the reach of most politicians who look for things that they can show success in within a few years. It is never the topic of the front page news. There are bits and pieces which enter the news, but it's never the front page news. On the other hand, when there is a big economic crisis, like for instance in 2008, 2009, all the world stock markets were collapsing and countries were getting into major debt and all of this, science and technology are continuing to progress without interruption. And that's very important to understand. There is a time delay. There is no clear connection between the time sequence. And it has an implication for an institute like this or for any other basic research institute, because what you do today is going to be converted to benefits, economic and others, not in the next few years, but in the next few decades. And this is something that is humanly difficult to absorb. Even if you understand it intellectually, it's very difficult to make your daily decision on the basis of things that are going to materialize in 10 or 20 years, and I will show you examples, very dramatic example in a few minutes. There's one other thing which I would say. If science and technology and knowledge in general is the leading economic commodity, then the best investment in the world is education. And this is not a slogan anymore. It was always said that the most important thing is education. But forget the intellectual value of education. From pure economic value, the best investment is education. But it's not a short-term investment. It's going to give fruits in a decade or two or three. Again, not attractive for politicians. And if you do the right decisions, the person who will get the fruits will be someone else who will not remember you. And if you will make a dramatic mistakes in education, the person who will pay for it will be someone else, and nobody will remember that you made a mistake. So it's very cruel and it's very unfair, but that's the way it is. And again, there are hundreds of examples to this in all fields of education, not only science and technology, but particularly science and technology. One last thing in this general introduction. There's a big danger, a big social danger, and we should be aware of it. If science and technology and education are the leading commodity, you have to remember that scientific talents, Let's put it in street language. Brains have been distributed among people in a less egalitarian way than working hands. And therefore, there is a big danger of growing economic gaps within countries and between different countries as a result of the dominance of science and technology on the economic scene. Because if you go back to the Industrial Revolution in the middle of the 19th century, when people began to learn to read and write and to make a living by working with their hands in industry and in other things, this was much more egalitarian than when you have to create the knowledge and the economic value with your brain. There's a joke which says that when God distributed health and money and brains among the people, the brains were distributed in the most fair way. Why? Because nobody complains that he didn't get enough brains. But that's a joke. The reality is the exact opposite. The distribution of talent in that direction is less egalitarian than the distribution of many other things. So this is just a general introduction which we have to keep in mind, because this is the panorama in which everything we say is happening. Now comes the next issue. How do you convert basic research? We are here, IST Austria, also my home institute, the Weizmann Institute, is an institute of basic research. How does that contribute to knowledge, to the welfare of society, to economic values, to anything. First, we should say again and again and again, and I think every one of you should say it every morning when he wakes up and every evening before he or she goes to sleep. Science continues to be as beautiful and exciting and intellectually rewarding as it always was. The fact that it is now also the leading economic commodity does not take away from all of this. So don't interpret what I'm telling you. I will discuss mostly economic value. So don't interpret it as if I lost my belief or my enthusiasm for the beauty and the intellectual value of science. And this, especially in an institute of basic research, should be repeated like a mantra every morning, every evening, because that is really the essence of what we do. We try to understand the most fundamental and beautiful questions in nature. How do we contribute then to the economy? We contribute in several different ways. We first of all, as schools, in this case a graduate school, contribute the people who will do the science, not only in academia, but also in industry, in R&D departments of major industries, and will create new products and new inventions. We contribute it by associating industrial parks, like the one that is going to be built here, with research institutes. The whole Silicon Valley grew up around Stanford, and there are now endless places. The first Silicon Valley-like industrial park in the world outside of the United States was created actually by the Weizmann Institute, next to the Weizmann Institute. Now there are hundreds of companies there. It started with a few companies that were based on the knowledge and the science that came from the Institute. Now the majority of the companies have nothing to do with the Weizmann Institute. It's of course many, many times smaller than Silicon Valley, but it's very, very large. The third thing, in addition to the creation of scientifically trained people in industrial park, are of course the scientific discoveries, and I'm not talking about intellectual property in the sense of patents and things of that sort that you can make money on and protect, just intellectual scientific discoveries, laws of nature if you want. Laws of nature are not something you can patent, but laws of nature are enormous contribution in many, many different ways because everything else depends on them. So don't kid yourself that if you are discovering an important new law of nature and you didn't make money on it except for your salary, that you are not contributing to the economic welfare of your society, your country, your world. But then, of course, and that's the main topic that we will discuss, there is the intellectual property which you can own, which you can patent, and which you can have copyright, and which you can temporarily, because on the scale of what I've been talking about, 10, 15, 20 years of the life of a patent is only temporarily, can make money on. And when I say you, I don't mean you personally, I mean the institute and also the inventor. And we'll come back to this. Now, it's very important to understand that like in many legal situations, we have different categories of knowledge and the borders between them are very, very gray. There is no clear dividing line. There is the general knowledge, like laws of nature, like discoveries of new, let's say you discover a new, in my field of particle physics, you discover a new particle. You cannot patent a new particle which you discovered. You cannot do with it anything except that it can change the world. Whoever discovered the electron, Thomson, in 1897, changed the world. Although it was not in the news at that time. But it is definitely correct that more than half of the economy of the world today is based on our understanding the electron and its properties. So you are changing the world, but you cannot patent it. The second thing is the wisdom and experience that you accumulate, which can make you a very good advisor, consultant to industry. And I believe firmly that for an institute of basic research, it is important to encourage its people to spend a small amount of time, not half of the time, and not a major part of the time, and not their main interest, but if they are wanted by somebody as advisors or consultant with their experience and knowledge, this is definitely another contribution of the research institute to society, whether it is, again, to industry, or like in my own personal case, I've been spending the last 50 years in helping science education, the educational system in my own country and in other countries, without any reward. And I must say this made me feel extremely good, even though I never earned 1 cent out of it. Because you feel that you can change the life, in this case of education, of children and other people. And this is something which is very important. But last but not least, patents are important not only because the institute and the inventors can derive income from them, but also because otherwise many of these discoveries will never be developed, especially in the pharmaceutical area. If you invent a new cure or a new drug for something, if it cannot be patented, no pharma company will take it. So the patent is not only to your benefit, it's a win-win-win-win situation at the end, even if the pharma company is doing some unpleasant business with it, as they often do. Because eventually the patent will expire, and eventually this will become public property. But until that happens, they have to invest an enormous amount, they will make an enormous amount of money, and the institute and you will do so also. A few examples in a few minutes. So we have these three areas, the general knowledge and general scientific discoveries. We have the consulting, and we have the well-defined, patented and copyrighted and or copyrighted intellectual property. And as I said, the borderlines are not clear. There are many cases in which it is very clear what it is, and there are many cases which it is not clear. Some of the biggest successes of the digital world have nothing to do with patents. For instance, the idea of creating a huge company that sells books like Amazon, which eventually started selling almost everything else under the sun. You cannot patent the idea that you will sell books over the internet. But somebody had this idea and somebody made an enormous fortune out of it. So there are such things. On the other hand, there are the other things like a new drug, which is an entirely different story. And this is something that I have to say immediately now to this mixed audience of different sciences. We are talking about technology transfer, we are talking about high tech, we are talking about startups. This is a very strange soup. Developing a new drug and inventing Facebook are two completely different operas. You can invent Amazon or Facebook or the first computer of Steve Jobs without a BA, or Bill Gates without a BA. You cannot develop a new medication, a new drug, without laboratories, PhD, clinical experiments, hospitals, and an enormous apparatus which belongs to the academic world. And these are two completely different things. So you cannot dream that you will be a cell biologist or something like that, and you will do in your garage what Steve Jobs has done when he built the first Apple computer. Or, again, to quote Amazon or Facebook. It's a completely different story. Also, the property rules are completely different. Software cannot be patented in the same way that drugs can be patented. Also in the case of drugs, and again, when I come to the case stories and the examples, you can patent a molecule. Let's take the most famous case of all, aspirin. Aspirin is a very old drug which was designed to kill pain. It's a painkiller. And then many, many years later, it turned out that it is also an anticoagulant. It dilutes your blood and it helps to prevent certain heart problems. Now, if you own the patent for the molecule and I found that your molecule is doing something that you didn't dream about, who owns that knowledge that I found? Is it you because you own the molecule, or is it me because I discovered something you didn't even dream about when you discovered that molecule? And there are billions which are floating around in the world on that issue again and again and again. The process in which the basic knowledge becomes intellectual property, I like to classify the different ways into five different categories. And it's worth our time to go very quickly through each one of them because they're very different and it gives you the versatility of the whole thing. The first, and if you wish, the most boring version is the logical version. You discover what you tried to discover. You start on a path, you want to answer a well-defined question, and you find the answer. If you are discovering a new, for instance, take the whole sequence of discovering the atom and the nucleus and the proton and the quark, this is very logical. And at every step, there was an attempt to discover the components of the previous step. Very logical. Structural biology or structural chemistry, when you have a well-defined molecule, like DNA or certain enzymes or this or that, and you know what is the molecule and you want to fully understand its three-dimensional structure with all the different ways in which this can be done, and then you use that three-dimensional structure for specific purposes, either to modify the molecule or to block it in certain situations, which would be already in the medical area, or anything else that you want to do, that is a very logical process. So possibility number one is the logical direction. Possibility number two is what is called mistakenly luck. You are looking for one problem, you luckily observe something else, which is totally unrelated to what you were looking for, and then you use that and you get to somewhere which you never thought about. Let me tell you a little story. If you go back to the middle 1990s, basically from 1990 until 2000, there were three drugs in the world which were used to treat people with multiple sclerosis. Very nasty illness. None of them really cured it, but all of them allowed for a good maintenance for people with multiple sclerosis. It so happened, by complete accident, that all of these three drugs were invented or paid royalties to the Weizmann Institute. And since I had to deal with this as president of the Weizmann Institute at that time, I know exactly the story. And I want to tell you the story because there are some absolutely mind-boggling features there. First of all, the Weizmann Institute has a very good department of neurobiology, and multiple sclerosis is a neurological disorder. But all the three drugs that were treating multiple sclerosis did not come from the Department of Neurobiology of the Weizmann Institute. They came from other departments. That's already weird. One came from immunology, and that is half reasonable because it's an autoimmune disease. But the two others came from a department that does not exist anymore, and it was called virology. And later it was called molecular cell biology. Or molecular genetic, it changes names and features, doesn't matter. What does virology has to do with multiple sclerosis? What happened was that in the Department of Virology, an antiviral drug that was treating herpes was discovered, was developed by a Swiss company, by an Israeli subsidiary of a Swiss company, and was marketed with moderate success, not great success, all over Europe and a little bit in the United States. That has nothing to do with multiple sclerosis. But there was a patent on that molecule. And then somebody in the United States, who didn't even know that there was such an antiviral drug, investigated the same molecule and found out that it is effective against multiple sclerosis and produced a different drug with a different name based on exactly the same molecule. So it was essentially the same drug done by an American company, which didn't even know about the Swiss company. And the Swiss company and the American company started suing each other for patent violations, patent infringement, and they finally reached an agreement that each one of them will pay a small amount of royalties to the other on all their income. The Swiss company that was in relation to the Weizmann Institute didn't tell the Weizmann Institute that they were now making money from the sales of the American company of the same drug that is based on the same molecule that was found at the Weizmann Institute. But the Weizmann Institute found out that they were doing it and that they were not telling us. And there was a long story, which I will return to when I discuss some legal issues later. And the result was, at the end of the story, that there were three different drugs, two of them based on the same molecule, the other completely different. And that was the whole global market for that particular dreadful disease. Now you say, how lucky can you get? And this was not even one of the main themes and main effort of the Weizmann Institute. So you have God knows how many people working on cancer research, and you are not curing one person from cancer, and you have a very minor effort on multiple sclerosis, and the whole world of medications for multiple sclerosis come from your institute. Well, if you want, you say luck. But you know, luck is a very funny thing. If you buy a lottery ticket and you win, and there are 1 million tickets, and you win the 1 million euro prize, there is a probability of 1 to 1 million that you will win. But somebody is going to win the 1 million. So there's a probability of 100% that an event of a probability of 1 in 1 million will happen. Now, the reason I'm making this silly statement is in order to say that if you are working on a very wide front of projects, let's say in biology or biomedical research with the purpose of developing drugs, and you are very alert to anything which you find accidentally, namely you're trying to cure one disease and you find that the molecule is good for something else, or anything of that sort, which happens to everybody several times in their career. But if you are among those who knows how to catch this accident and to run after it and push it to the extreme, you are going to be the winner of the lottery. And in a way, the fact that somebody is winning is not a matter of luck. The question whether the lucky guy is Mr. X or Miss Y, that's a matter of luck. But the point is, if you have 1,000 research projects of biomedical nature and some of them are winning, that's not really too much of a matter of luck. And the fact is that it's happening again and again in the same places. I don't know any place in the world that has done great success from intellectual property and did it only from one product. It's not in the nature of the business. This was the second case, the second nature that's luck. The third is what I call the Cinderella process. Suddenly, a totally useless scientific field becomes the mother of all uses in a certain field. The most dramatic example is number theory. Number theory, if you ask me 30 years ago, I would have told you that number theory is a beautiful field of mathematics, and I cannot think of one field of science that is more useless than number theory. And you know very well that today, whenever you buy anything in the internet with your credit card, not to speak of the whole business of encryption and military encryption and commercial encryption and all of this, it is all based on methods, or almost all based on methods, from number theory, beginning with the famous work of RSA, Rivet, Shamir, and Edelman in the 80s in MIT. And so suddenly a field that you would never dream has any implication or application becomes the real Cinderella, and everybody is after it, and it becomes, it almost becomes top secret that you're an expert in that field because there are so many ramifications of it. The first item, the first direction is you're doing something in science that develops into a completely new, different technology from what you were planning to. The most famous example are lasers. Lasers were developed without any eye to applications. It was, in a way, a fascinating exercise in quantum mechanics of light. And if you now look at all the applications of lasers, whether it's in medicine and compact discs and endless application from saving life to killing people, basically, with lasers, you see how far that can happen with a technology that was born from a science that never even dreamt about having a technology derived from it. And the fifth and the last direction, in a way, is the most fascinating one, and it's also connected to particle physics, my own field, nothing to do with me. And that is, sometimes in science, you are in a field in which you have to use the ultimate extreme instrumentation. Particle physics is the field which deals with the smallest objects in the world, by definition, trying to find the tiniest sub components of matter, and also with the largest objects in the world, because it's intimately related to the cosmos, to the universe, to the creation of the universe, to the Big Bang, because any theory of the early universe, the first trillions of a second of the universe, must assume that the smallest particles started the process. So here you are with a field which is dealing only with the largest data system, the largest accelerators, the largest magnetic field, etc., etc. Now, what does that have to do with commercialization? It looks like nothing. But when you need the strongest magnet and the strongest electric fields and the strongest, the largest databases, and so on and so forth, you have to develop experimental systems which will create this. And then they have completely different uses that you didn't dream about. And if you look at computerized tomography, magnetic resonance imaging, and the World Wide Web, all three were born from particle physics exactly in this way. They have nothing to do with particle physics. But they were born from technologies that were invented in order to enable you to study the smallest objects in the world or the largest objects in the world. And the World Wide Web was simply because they were doing experiments with 500 participants in 50 different universities in 10 different countries with huge amounts of data. And it needed a solution to the question of how to prevent the same members of the same group of 500 scientists to repeat what others have done, to benefit from what others have done, to be completely familiar. So they created these databases which everybody could get into and everybody who had the permission could modify or could add or could subtract or could do a search. And basically this the whole HTML language and everything related to the World Wide Web was born from that. And without getting into the detail with magnetic resonance, I will just mention the story of computerized tomography because it's amazingly simple. When I was a young student, the only way to look at interactions among particles was to look at photographs of bubble chambers. Bubble chambers were essentially containers with high pressure, usually hydrogen. And when a particle went through it, it would have left a trace of bubbles behind it. And you would look at the bubbles and you would see where the particle was. So you would look at particle interactions. There would be a particle coming here, another one coming here. They would collide. They will create five new particles. And that's how you discovered particles in the 60s, 50 years ago. What does that have to do with computerized tomography, you ask? Well, the picture is two-dimensional, like every picture. So you see the particle, and you see the other particle, and you have no idea if they interact, or one is here and one is here, or the other way. So how do you solve it? You take three pictures from three different angles, and you reconstruct them to a three-dimensional picture or image. And then, of course, if the particles cut each other, the particle traces meet each other in all three directions, the particles indeed met. And if not, you can, by looking at the three different directions, you can see which one in front, which one in the back, etc. So you can reconstruct a complete three-dimensional picture, and then you can slice it any way you wish from the three-dimensional computerized reconstruction. It was only a small step to convert this from visible light to X-rays, and there you are with computerized tomography, which is exactly that story. You take the picture from several different angles with X-rays, you create a three-dimensional picture, and then you can slice this any way you want. And that has happened in the 60s as a direct result of software and methodology that was developed. So if I go back to the five different processes, very quickly, there's the logical, straightforward approach. There is the so-called luck or serendipity. There is the Cinderella situation of a useless field that becomes very useful. There is the science which converts to a whole new technology. And there is the development of technical aids for the scientific work, which then become useful by themselves. And these are, of course, there are other variations and combinations, but basically, these are the main areas. Now, just to reach the conclusion of much of what I want to say, I will still spend a few minutes on the administration of such things. I want just to briefly tell you in a very personal way how in the last 50 or so years I found myself involved in this, because it's really you're looking at a scientist who has never discovered anything that is worth money, never had a patent, never made money on any patent or intellectual property. And how does this happen? And it's very, very interesting, because it gives you an idea of the whole thing. So when I was 20, I came to do my master's thesis, and I was using the computer that the Weizmann Institute had at that time. At that time, it was the second fastest computer in the world, in a country which had literally no food. And there was 100 grams of beef per week per person, rationed by the government. But the Kaiser Weizmann Institute invested a huge amount of money in building a computer. Why? Because there was a scientist, an outstanding scientist, who wanted to calculate the energy level of the helium atom. Completely crazy. That computer led to the first school of computer science, the first graduate school of computer science, to the fact that eventually this was the second country after the United States that was connected to the internet, to an enormous amount of startup companies in that field, which are today, but which were already there in the 80s. And in a way, it also very indirectly touched on IST Austria. If Tom Hensinger will allow me, I will tell this story. When I was 21, I got my master's degree, and I had to go to the army, like everybody else in Israel. But you could do it before the university or after. And the army just bought its first computer. It had a memory of 64K. It cost $2 million. It filled the room about like that. And they collected 20 of the most brilliant kids for the first programming course. And we took the programming course, and I had to solve the problem that if you have an infantry brigade with a medical doctor in it, the medical doctor, if he wants to go on vacation, he has to ask the commander of the brigade. But if he wants to put an IV to an injured, he has to go to the medical corps to find out how to do it. So he has two bosses, even though he is only one person, and the computer didn't know how to solve it. So that was my job, my first job. In that course, I met another friend who became later a famous computer scientist. He then moved to Stanford. At Stanford, he had an Austrian PhD student by the name of Thomas Hensinger. And he one day told me that Tom Hensinger would be an ideal president for IST Austria, and he was right. So that's another application of computers. But more seriously, this was the introduction of a whole thing which you see how it took 20 or 30 or 40 years to bear the fruit. In 1959, the Weizmann Institute established a company to exploit patents and processes which can be commercialized. This was very early on in the game, 1959. And by 1989, 30 years later, that company was making $1 million a year, not a lot of money. It actually cost more or less the same, because you had to pay for the patents and the lawyers and this and that. 10 years later, that company was making $60 million a year. And 10 years ago, we reached a point that that company was making per year on the patents of the Weizmann Institute a larger amount of money than the total budget of the institute at that time. And more important, industry in Israel, in the world, produced products of $25 billion based on inventions that were coming from that institute. And the Weizmann Institute is a good institute, but it's not the best institute. There are better institutes in the world. We have no illusion about it. So the question is, how does that happen? And with that, I will answer and conclude. It has to be based on a formula, and I see no reason why that formula would not work here. Item number one, you have to go for scientific quality and trust that the so-called luck will come. Scientific quality is not only catching the best persons, but also avoiding fields in which you cannot have excellent people, namely choosing people by field, by quality and not by field, which is exactly one of the principles of this institute. You have to have freedom from government, from industry, from donors, from anybody who would try to divert your effort. You should go after the best basic research that you can. But if in going after the best basic research that you can, you accidentally or not accidentally find something that is worth developing, patenting, commercializing, don't be ashamed to do it. You are not less of an excellent scientist if in the process of solving the secrets of nature, you are commercializing something. But you are definitely not a good scientist if you are going only after the commercializing and abandoned the search of what you really wanted to do. And that's an extremely crucial issue. And don't change the research directions just because somebody else wants you, because the government say you should be more applied research, or some industry wants you to do some very routine work or something like that. And if you discover the molecule that is potentially going to solve some medical problem, and somebody has to change to check whether it's toxic, that's not very interesting work. Let the pharma company do it. Don't do it yourself. So the idea is, you go with your basic research, but you keep all the time an eye on possible benefits. And if it is part of your program, continue with it. If it is not, try to find some commercial interest who will use it. You have to have very clear rules about it, and that's very, very important. It's also important that in every research group, there is a little bit of an entrepreneurial spirit, that there are many sources of income in many different directions. It's also important that in the organization, there are clear rules. What can you do about consulting? What can you do about publishing? One of the rules, never delay publishing. At most, delay by a month until you can apply for a patent. Don't keep secrets your results, because then you're violating all the principles of free research and basic research. And you can always, if you can protect your discovery by a patent, it takes just a few weeks to apply for the patent. If you cannot protect it by a patent, then there is no reason not to publish. So free publishing is a crucial issue for such a thing. If you close yourself like the R&D company, the R&D departments of companies, you're going to destroy the quality, and the good people will avoid coming to this institute. That's part of the important. It's very important that the intellectual property within the institute will be managed by a scientist who is one level removed from the head of the institute. In other words, if the institute is headed like here by a president, eventually, when there are many, many patents here, there should be a scientist who is vice president for technology transfer. And then there should be a company which is dedicated with a manager, with a professional manager, who is dedicated to exploiting it. And finally, there is something in Europe which is happening again and again, which is very bad for the scientists and for the institutions. There's a tendency of scientists to sneak away from the institute with the intellectual property. By law, the intellectual property belongs to the institute. The rule normally is that the institute commercializes it and gives the inventors 1/3 or 40%, depending on the institution, of the income. Now, there is a simple statement in mathematics, very profound statement of mathematics, which says that 40% of a lot is more than 100% of a little. That's deep mathematics. And what I'm trying to say by this is that if the institute is geared to commercializing things, to patenting everything and paying for the patent for many years until they can be commercialized, and then the institute is paying the scientists 40%, and when the companies are trying to cheat the institute has enough power and money to fight them in courts and in every other way, the scientists will end up with 40% of a lot. And if the scientists try to sneak away dishonestly by inventing all kinds of ways, and it's possible to invent all kinds of ways of sneaking away with the commercial with the patents, as is very frequently the case in European universities, the scientists may end up with 100%, but of very little. And the business of defending yourself is something very, very important. You remember what I told you about the three drugs of multiple sclerosis? The way we've been defending ourselves is the following. First of all, we never sell a patent. We license it. We continue to own the patent forever. First of all, morally, some drug company can take the patent and bury it in order not to develop a competition to some other drug that they have. And that's highly immoral. And you should not allow such a thing to happen. So you license them to use the patent, but if you see that they are not doing it, you can take it back if you continue to own the patent. The second thing is that if somebody is playing dirty tricks, you always have the option of taking back the patent. I told you the case of the two companies that were suing each other in multiple sclerosis for infringement of patents. And finally, they paid each other royalties, but they didn't tell us. So they were both making money on our intellectual property without telling us, us meaning the Weizmann Institute. The only way we could cope with it at that time was to threaten them that we will take the patent back and they will remain without the drug, and then we will license it to someone else. And this is a short sentence of something that took 3 years, and we finally won and received it. We had another drug company that did something else. They created a subsidiary in the United States. They sold them at half price, the drug, and the subsidiary sold at full price to the customer. And then they paid us the royalties from the half price because they were supposed to pay only the royalties from the sales of the company itself. I mean, intellectual property is something which you do not see. So it's easy to play games with. And academic institutions all over the world are considered soft targets. So one of the things that you have to do is you have to fight. You have to fight with logic, you have to fight morally, and you have to fight legally. And this the institute can do, and you personally cannot do. So all of these things, these are just half a dozen or a dozen angles of a process which is extremely complicated. And an institute can succeed in a fantastic way in this if it is high quality. I say that our success is based 50% on the quality of the institute, 50% on the correct management, and 50% on luck. And then you ask, how much is 50 plus 50 plus 50? In this case, it's 100, because it's not additive. It's not that if you have one of them, you would get half of the money. If you would have one of the three, you would get nothing. It's the three of them that have to combine like a beautiful orchestra in order to be able to do it. And in my opinion, if you stick to basic research, the main income in the future, 20, 30, 40 years from now, of good quality or first-class basic research institute in the world will come from that, from commercialization of inventions and patents. That's my feeling. That's how it is today already at the Weizmann Institute. And we are not better than others. We were a little bit lucky and a little bit found the correct things. One last sentence. Okay, so you made a lot of money out of this, the institute. What do you do with it? Do you spend it to expand the institute? My answer is no. You don't expand the institute beyond the quality of the good people that you can hire anyway. And any invention, any patent can disappear overnight. A drug can become unsafe, can kill a few people and be declared illegal by the authority. Any other discovery can be surpassed by somebody who invented something better. It's a very volatile graph of income as a function of time. So you cannot base your volume of activity on the amount of money that you make every year from this. The only way to handle it, and that's what we've been doing, is to put all of this money into a foundation, into an endowment, and then you draw every year a fixed percentage of the income to maintain the institute. So the worst that can happen to you is that you are not discovering anything new, you have no more patents, you have no more income. Then you still have all of this endowment, which gives you an annual income. And the best would be that you are making more discovery and your endowment is getting larger and larger and larger, and it's covering larger and larger percentage of your budget. But that is the other aspect of the thing. Again, you have to have the vision of what's going to happen 20, 30 years from now, and not how to solve your problems for next week because you don't have enough money to pay the salary of Mr. X or Ms. Y for the next month. So with all of this collection of truth, I think it's a whole new world which is coming to every first-class basic research institute. And I definitely see the future of IST Austria also bright in that direction. And I hope so. And I think if the institute will make all the right decisions, it will exactly happen like this. And all of this, I will say now for the 10th time, provided you do not let all of this money and patents and commercialization divert you from the pursuit of first-class basic research. That mantra, I repeat, every morning, every evening you have to say it, and if you want, also for lunch. Because it's very, very important. It's so easy to divert from this and start running after the money and become like an R&D division of, I don't know what, of Apple or Siemens or Merck or whatever. And then the best people will not come to work here and your level will drop and that will be, it will take another 10 or 20 years and that will be the end. The end of quality, not the end of the institute. The institute, you know, institutes have a life of their own. They will continue to exist. So I think what you have to take from this is that A, there's a whole new world out there. B is the mantra that you have to say at least twice, preferably three times a day. And that it is definitely possible, and I predict that it will happen, that all first-class basic research institutes will find themselves in this lucky situation of having a lot of income from this and contributing to humanity in this way, because 95% of all of these things are good contributions to humanity after all. I mean, it's definitely the medications, whether the invention of Facebook is a great contribution to humanity, I have my doubt, but that's a subject of a different lecture. Thank you.